Darryl, would you like to get us started?
Yeah, thanks, Ryan. So when I'm speaking, I'm going to take my mask off. We are all vaccinated and we're spaced out in a big area, so I think we're good. And I want to thank Jennifer and Lorraine for being here to help me out with this, and Ryan for the technology. I also want to thank Anne-Marie and Tom and Jean, our board members on the phone, for their help with our strategic planning process, and also Bobby Beeman, who serves on our strategic planning committee, who may be on the phone or not, I'm not sure. It's a team effort for sure. And you know, we meet year round. And so this is kind of the crux of a lot of the work, is the revision of the plan in this case. So anyway, it's a team effort. I appreciate everyone's input and help, and thank you all for your time today and listening. You know, what we want to do is make sure that you all know what we're working on as a public entity. We want to make and take your input and look forward to that at the end for sure. And we can have more open dialogue or you can use chat function wherever you're comfortable with. So the first thing is I want to say, you know, our existing strategic plan was created in 2019 and it was meant to carry us through 2022. However, you know, some things have changed and a revision seems prudent at this time. That said, given the challenges of the last 18 months, I'm proud to say we got a lot of things done in the plan, and I want to talk about those for a minute. I think many know we completed our cancer center medical oncology addition earlier this year that expanded our MedOnc services there in SQIM, as well as a much larger, more appropriately sized pharmacy for chemotherapy services. Got that one done. We started almost 2 years ago and finished right at the end of 2020, was the pretty significant remodel of the main hospital building basement that increased our capacity and our central sterile processing, which does all of the instrumentation, cleaning, and so on. For our whole organization, that's all the clinics, the OR, you know, and the floors and everything else. So a lot of work there that we got done as well. That was a multi-million dollar, hopefully once a career endeavor. It was remodeling the basement of a facility like this is not easy. So anyway, got that done, and which proud of that one. Across our clinic system, we've had a decrease of opioid prescription rates, which is of 33%, which was in our strategic plan that we created in 2019. So some good progress there. We made some huge improvements in our call centers and reduced wait times. Some of that was technological, but a lot of it was just a lot of hard work from our staff to find better workflows that actually, you know, resulted in increased access for patients. So proud of that one and glad that that's something that we've been able to operationalize going forward. We did some really focused planning in our cancer center around just the way we operate. We're adding a second linear accelerator, getting ready to launch that construction project in next month, actually. But that's been a two-year process. So a lot of work on the cancer center side from a strategic perspective. And in our primary care clinics, in our Olympic Medical Physicians division, a lot of focus work there over the last year or so that has launched that service in a new bright positive direction. So those are some real good work along those lines that we've completed. We've managed to hit our net income goal of 2%, which is not a huge margin, but fairly typical for a public hospital such as us. And you know, so that's another goal that we've hit. We're going to take another look at that one as we go forward. And we're able to increase our reserves. We like to measure our reserves in a figure called days cash on hand, which essentially means, you know, if we stop receiving money tomorrow, how long can OMC operate? Our goal was 90 days, and we hit that at the end of 2020. I want to talk for just a minute about the current environment, and this kind of brings us as to why we're revising the plan now. I know that everyone's very aware of the pandemic and how that's changed all of our lives, not just at work, but at home and everything else. It's had a dramatic impact on us. But here within OMC, we have more people than ever in some state of crisis. whether it's in our ER, in our clinics, on our floors, and they're coming to us, you know, with crisis around substance abuse, acute mental health illness, and a lot of folks that are, you know, advanced dementia with no support system. These folks are in our system every day and sometimes spend a lot of time here at OMC. That's something that has become more intense in the last, especially 6 to 8 months, I would say. It's always been there, but it seems to us that those numbers are increasing and becoming a bigger piece of the work that we do every single day here. A whole new focus on healthcare equity, diversity, equity, and inclusion. These are all things that our core values have always lent themselves to and that we've done well. That said, the world is different in this way and something that we want to take another look at. And Jennifer will actually talk a bit more about that here shortly. But that's a whole new area that we need to raise our game, so to speak. Telehealth and remote care. Things like looking at me on a screen instead of being in Linkletter Hall. I feel like this is something that we'll always have to be chasing. We don't have unlimited resources, but we still want to be moving forward in this way. And patients expect us to have tools so that they can more easily access us via some of these new technological platforms. Some things that haven't really changed much for us, and that is, you know, Medicare and Medicaid still pay us quite a bit less than our costs. So for every dollar it takes us to take care of somebody on Medicare or Medicaid, we're reimbursed less than that. So that creates a difficult financial situation and something that we continue to have to deal with and continue just to fight for in our advocacy efforts. And workforce is another huge issue that I know not just OMC, but probably every hospital, at least in the state, if not the whole country, is struggling with right now, having the right workforce. And Jennifer will talk a little bit more about that. So that's a little bit about the current environment. So from that, we've, you know, here some main themes in this revision are around diversity, equity, and inclusion. And so some concepts and goals around that will be woven into the new plan. Increased focus on mental health. We've always had components of that in our strategic plan, and you know, our vision isn't to be doing that, but working with others in the community and everyone figuring out, you know, kind of how do we best care for these folks, because they're in our hospital every day, so we need to do better and be serving them in new ways. And I've talked about workforce. That's obviously a huge theme in our revision. And reimbursement, you know, we are relying on 83% of our revenue comes from some sort of government payment mechanism system, be it Medicare, Medicaid, or some of the smaller government payers. That's 83% of our business. And again, most in nearly all those cases, we're paid less than our costs. So that's a challenge for us. And all of these efforts will require, you know, not just us going it alone, but working with community partners, which I feel fortunate to have. Some out-of-the-box approaches to how we do things here at OMC. How do we do it better? How do we think a little bit differently and do the best we can with the resources that are available to us? And I mentioned advocacy. That's something that continues here at OMC, whether it's at the state level or the federal level, to make sure that we're doing all we can on that front as well to advocate for ourselves. The plan, like the previous plan, the number one goals are around safety, quality, and patient satisfaction, our patient experience. And I think that's how we're going to win, so to speak. If we do those things well, I think the financial picture takes care of itself. We need to be the provider of choice for our community. And that's really what we're striving for at the end of all this. So these are all just ways we're going to try to get there. So this is a revision. This wasn't a rip and replace. I'm the new guy. We're going to blow it up and start over. I'd say 75 to 80% of the plan that we're working under is still great. And I think has served us very, very well as we've worked through what has been an amazingly challenging time in healthcare. Our mission, vision, and values remain intact. They served us well thus far, and we're going to continue to be successful under those. But there are some things, like I said, we've got them done, and there's just the environment has changed enough that a revision seems prudent at this time. So that's why we're doing it. And, you know, so we're doing a series of these forums. We've done, I don't know, 6 or 7 of them. And I think we have one more with our employees, with a group of employees on Monday night. So we want feedback, we want questions, and our goal is to have a new plan to distribute in August. So that's kind of our rough timeline. So with that, I'll stop, and I'm going to hand it over to Lorraine to talk a bit about some of the financial pieces of the new plan.
Thank you, Darryl. Thank you. I get to remove my mask. So I'm Lorraine Cannon. I am the Chief Financial Officer. I've been here just over a year. We're going to be talking about the financial strategic plans. It helps to maintain. We're gonna
move our text pretty good, but we might have to switch. So sorry, Lorraine.
We're good. It just really likes you, Darryl. It's that magnetic personality.
Mm-hmm.
Our financial strategic plan's goal is to help us maintain a strong, locally owned and controlled public hospital so that we can meet the demands of the community now and into the future. OMC is a not-profit governmental agency, and we must maintain sound financial results over time in order to invest in facilities and equipment, invest in new and expanded services, and make principal payments on our long-term debt. There are going to be 3 financial metrics that we are going to help show continual financial improvement. The first one is we're going to be budgeting our net revenue as a percentage of earnings, what Darryl was calling a margin. It was 2% in the original strategic plan. That was pretty much considered the standard for not-for-profit hospitals. With increasing cost and changing reimbursement, we feel we need to adjust our goal to keep us competitive. So to achieve that, we're going to be setting a goal of 3% over a rolling 5-year average. So what does that mean? That means that for every dollar we earn, we're going to earn 3 cents on the bottom line at the end of it. So for every dollar that we make, we're going to get to take $3 to the bank.
3 cents.
3 cents, I'm sorry, 3 cents to the bank. Oh, wouldn't it be nice if it were $3? The next thing is balance sheet strength. It's an industry standard for financial liability. Measuring days cash on hand, as Darryl mentioned, is a good indicator. It represents if the facility had no more cash coming in, how many days would we be able to continue? Currently, our goal is 90%, 90 days, and we've met that goal in December of 2020. We're going to be increasing our days cash on hand to 100 days by the year 2023. This increase is going to assist with purchasing power and increasing demand. Currently, top performers are at 159 days, but they also have more debt, which is another thing we're going to look at is our debt. Our debt-to-equity ratio is currently at 33%, and we're going to maintain that at 33%. So what is debt-to-equity ratio? If you think of your mortgage, if you own a house and it's worth $200,000, and if you can find one in Port A for that much, good luck. But if you can find a house for $200,000 and you owe $66,000, you have about a 33% debt-equity. That's what we're looking at. So we have how much everything is worth and how much debt do we have for that. And it's about 33% is where we're going to keep that. That is a strong percentage. The last thing we're going to do is we're going to reduce our primary denials from the 6.7% down to 5%. A primary denial is the refusal of an insurance company to honor the request for healthcare services. Those denials we do pursue. Once we get a denial from an insurance company, we do pursue that denial. But of course, that takes more personnel and it takes more time, slower collection of cash. And so if we can find ways to reduce that, it does help with us. The last thing we're going to be doing is we're going to be increasing our productivity by 2% on an ongoing basis. And that will be done by improving productivity processes, growing volumes to meet the needs of our community, managing expenses, and reducing waste. Salary and benefits are the largest percentage of our expense at OMC. Currently, for every dollar we're spending, we spend 61 cents on salary and wages. It's not unusual that it is the largest expense in hospitals. So I think it's important that we maintain that to keep us viable. We want to achieve employee compensation of 61% and maintain that over time to help our financial viability. I'll take questions at the end if you have them, but at this point, I'm going to turn it over to Jennifer to talk about human resources and...
The link.
Thank you.
And other. Good afternoon, everyone. Glad to have you join us today in our community roundtable. We're so delighted to have our stakeholders and partners embark on this journey of revising our plan with us. The first topic that I'll address is diversity, equity, and inclusion. As Darryl had mentioned, we're very excited about including a specific goal in our strategic plan along these lines, and we've drafted a goal. It's not entirely different from our long-held values and beliefs, of course. We have a firm foundation at Olympic Medical Center. Our mission is to provide excellence in healthcare, working together, and our seven core values of quality, safety, teamwork, compassion, respect, integrity, and stewardship all reflect those principles that are near to and dear to us. They are also a baseline from which to build on diversity and inclusion. We know we have more to do, and we want to take our commitment to the next level. So that's our goal with including this in the strategic plan. We will elevate equity to the point where it is in our strategic plan. Our Board of Commissioners has endorsed this, and we will have several action steps reflected in our diversity, equity, and inclusion goal. The first is to engage with a consultant, the Cross-Cultural Healthcare Program, CCHCP, which is a consultant founded in Seattle. They have been here for about 30 years working with healthcare organizations across Washington State, and in particular in the Puget Sound corridor and in our area. And they've helped a number of healthcare organizations to reach goals around diversity and inclusion. So we're really excited to work with them. The first step that they will help us with is developing our statement of equity and inclusion, a statement that we can show to the employees, we can all build upon as our principle within OMC. And second, we will conduct a gap analysis. We will have a survey go out to our employees so that we can ask questions around where we might be doing well and where we might need to improve. So we will get some baseline data from that. And then third, CCHCP will help us develop a roadmap of sustainable steps to continue this work into the future and to continue improving. We also have at the grassroots level a number of employees who have come forward during the last year as these topics have become closer to the fore of our national conversations. And so these employees have asked to be involved in a diversity and equity committee, which we have formed now with frontline staff engaged in this work. And so I'm happy to report that the frontline staff are part of the consulting process with CCHCP, and in fact, we had a wonderful introductory call with the consultant yesterday with our grassroots committee, who was able to offer insights and ask questions to help us develop the work and make sure that it is very inclusive as we move ahead. Then finally, we are going to be leveraging statewide resources. So we're very enthusiastic about working with the Washington State Hospital Association, WISHA, on an 18-month health equity collaborative. And this is an initiative that will involve hospitals from across the state all working together. We don't want to reinvent the wheel as we embark on this journey, and we can share our experiences and share best practices. And through the guidance of WISHA, we're really looking forward to being able to leverage some of the learnings that we are able to glean over the next 18 months. So with all of that, we hope to put together an excellent report out on diversity, equity, inclusion very soon. So next I'll turn to workforce. This has been an area that we have focused on quite a bit in the last year. I'll start with the record number of employees that we have, 1,637. We also have our highest number of providers at approximately 113 providers. We have 379 registered nurses and 125 medical assistants. So all those numbers are good, they're burgeoning, our workforce is growing. That being said, recruitment continues to be a focus. We have 205 open posted positions at present. That means that this is a huge effort to actively engage in new strategies. We've been utilizing virtual job fair platforms. We are going to be having a traditional job fair on July 14th and 15th at our new building on the corner of Race and Front Street, where the Wells Fargo bank was located previously. So we'll have that job fair set up in the parking lot there in an effort to talk with those candidates who might be interested in employment. We're definitely looking at all the technology platforms that we can, leveraging third-party resources, and candidly just being as creative as possible to fill our open positions. Despite the workforce shortages that we do face, we have had a good run of recruiting in the last year, even though we've been facing a pandemic. And part of that is because of the good story that we've been able to tell in terms of our stability of our workforce and our organization. In 2020, OMC actually filled 693 positions. That does include our internal as well as external positions. We focus a lot on workforce development and career ladders. So internally, it was 357 positions that were filled by internal candidates. But externally, we filled 336 positions. So that was quite a few in 2020. We were able to share that OMC did not do any layoffs. We did not have furloughs. We didn't cut wages. And we didn't freeze hiring. There were measures that other healthcare organizations across the country had to consider and some had to adopt. But we found that we were able to work through the pandemic in a very stable manner, and we were able to keep our workforce not only intact, but add to it. As I indicated, we've been growing approximately 100 employees per year over the past 5 or 6 years. During the pandemic, we added about 50 employees net. This is in part also because of the retention, which is higher than national. Our retention percentages are higher than national average. That is, the turnover percentages are lower than national averages. And some of that is because of the focus that we have on workforce development and the career ladders that I spoke of a moment ago. We've worked with Peninsula College over the years, as well as our legislators, to add training spots to the registered nurse program, as well as the certified nursing assistant program and medical assisting program at Peninsula College. This year, we posted a record number of new graduate registered nurse positions, 26 open positions, and we've filled most of those at this time. We are also working hard to recruit our medical assistants, which are typically difficult to fill, and we always have open positions. Because of that, we have worked with Peninsula College, which has medical assistant program, and we added those training spots, as I mentioned. We also have an internal medical assistant apprenticeship program, which has been very successful, and our cohorts vary from 6 to 12 or 13 individuals per cohort, and we have generally 2 to 3 cohorts per year, and that's something that we have had on an ongoing basis for several years now and has grown to a very robust program with clinical educators and the like. This provides on-the-job training for MAs, and that's been very attractive to those who are seeking these entry-level positions. And so we hope to just continue to grow this program so that we can recruit and retain MAs. We also see that we have a number of CNA openings. So at this time, we're offering 100% tuition fees and books reimbursement for staff who want to enroll in Peninsula College's CNA program. We're really encouraging some of our employees who are in other areas and want to get into a clinical ladder. For example, if they're in dietary, environmental services, patient transport, or other positions, we're encouraging them actively to pursue the CNA certificate if they're interested. We've also implemented an in-house training program for surgical technicians, which we really needed to do, and we've been able to grow our own with surgical techs, which is another area that's been hard to fill for us. We also offer tuition reimbursement for our employees per a policy to support those whose educational goals match the needs that OMC has for its workforce. Turning to wellness, our Board of Commissioners has also endorsed a new plan that we have piloted this year and we're really excited about. It's called the Complete Health Improvement Program, or CHIP, which is a voluntary program in a structured wellness education setting. We purchased 100 spots for employees who might wish to volunteer for the program. We've trained 7 internal facilitators to help guide our employees, and we're just in the process of launching our open sessions so that we can get folks signed up for that. And we're really excited for this pilot to see how it's received and accepted. The continuum that it endorses is that of more plant-based foods, nutritional awareness, as well as exercise and improvement in habits such as sleep, mental health, reduction of stress, and establishing really good relationships and support systems. So we're excited about the CHIP program and hoping that this pilot results in a lot of success and we can continue our journey with wellness and support of our employees. A key focus for us has also been patient experience, and you'll see that in the strategic plan. This last year, we added staff for patient experience. So for example, in our emergency department, which has seen a lot of increases in both patients and in complexity of cases, we were able to add a patient experience advocate to assist with our patients and their visitors, and also to help our staff, especially as things were difficult during COVID and we had to restrict visitation based on safety measures. It was excellent to have that patient experience advocate, and we're actually adding another patient experience advocate to our emergency department presently. So we're really excited to add more staff and try to build out the support for our patients as well as our employees. One of the most important goals regarding patient experience is to continue to increase our communication, that we are patient-centered and showing that we are enhancing the employee-to-patient communication in everything that we can. We want to increase our courtesy and decrease wait times. And we are working on an age-friendly initiative, which we hope will really focus on the well-being of elderly and vulnerable patients who comprise a large percentage of our demographic. We're actively working on strategies to reduce the wait times in our emergency department, which we know is an issue. We're also looking at statistics around admission times and left without being seen, with the goal of reducing those and ensuring that our patients are well served. Finally, I'll touch on behavioral health, and there's not enough time to really delve into the complex topic of behavioral health, but suffice it to say that this has been woven into our strategic plan and will continue to be a strong focus. We have seen an increase in our community in the needs for mental health services, whether they are acutely mentally ill in our emergency department or in need of substance abuse crisis disorder services. We have seen these issues reflected in our emergency department, not only over the last year, but over the past several years. And we know that there are many needs in our community that we need to address. So we're actively working on the strategies to add staff, for example, add increased employees, and then also to increase training and resources. We're looking at further de-escalation training for those situations that might be somewhat chaotic or eventually looking as if they may escalate. We want our staff to be well prepared for de-escalation and proper treatment and care of our patients. And we are actively working on developing and reinforcing our community relationships with partners, such as some of you on the phone. We're really hoping to continue the dialogue with Rediscovery that helps the homeless in our community to continue partnering with Peninsula Behavioral Health to form really strong relationships and successes going forward, and to talk with law enforcement on an ongoing basis to understand what stresses and tensions they have, and just really to come together as a community to collaborate on a problem that we can't individually solve, but together we might be able to make some progress. So those are the topics on which I was asked to speak, and I will now turn it over to our moderator, Ryan.
Hey, Brian.
Thank you. Yeah.
Can I add a couple things?
Yeah, absolutely.
Yeah. So a couple things I want to mention in addition to the beginning part there was, there's two other initiatives that we are taking on that I wanted to mention. One of them is we are doing this summer, it's actually already been launched, a medical staff development plan. And you know what that is it takes a look at the demographics of our service area. It does some forecasts around growth and age and how all that kind of comes into play. It takes a look at a lot of the data from the hospital in terms of the kind of illnesses that we have here. And what it does is it overlays that on the number of providers that we have in our service area and tries to help us identify where there may be shortages or not. And so that's something that we're working on now that's also going to help us going forward with our recruiting efforts. That's going to help us understand, hopefully with a little bit more clarity, where do we try to hire our own versus where do we work with others? There are some specialists that folks in our community do need, and but there's not enough of them for us to have a whole program, but we want to be trying to take care of those folks here at home. So, and hopefully help us along that path and focus our recruiting efforts. The other item is we are looking at a pretty significant master planning process around the main hospital building here, the one we're seeing in the basement. And we used to have about 78 beds when I got here about 15 years ago. We now have 67. A lot of that was just due to the fact that we used to have double rooms and now we don't, which was definitely a good thing for patients. But it also means we have less spaces for patients. And there are definitely times where we run out of a type of bed. As of right now, our ICU and our telemetry unit are both full. It'd be nice to have a couple extra beds, right? And I think upstairs on our medical surgical unit, same thing. We are often full. And so we want to be taking another look at the hospital building kind of in 2021 as it is working for us today, and figure out how do we better utilize the space. Over the years, the east side of the hospital on the second and third floor have become largely office space. We're trying to move people out into homes, other places where they can have that office space that's less intense real estate or less expensive real estate where that's more suitable for an office, and trying to clear out the hospital so that as we move this project forward, we can create more patient care spaces. So that's another initiative that's, my vision is we would say, what do we want the hospital to look like in 10 years, and figure out what is the phased approach to move towards that. It's a multi-year project for sure. It's going to be in the millions of dollars, no doubt. But that's another initiative that we're also launching. So those are two things that are really going to form our planning process going forward that we're working on simultaneously. So, I forgot that. I mentioned those in the beginning. So Ryan.
Thank you. We're going to move to the Q&A portion of today's event now, where you can dialogue directly with our panelists if you would like. You can turn on your camera on your desktop or laptop if you wish. If you'd like to ask a question, we just ask you to raise your hand before you do so. You can raise your hand by finding the participants tab and then clicking on the hand by your name. If you're joining via phone, you can press *3 to raise your hand to ask a question or make a comment. While everyone's kind of getting settled, we have a couple questions in the chat from Karen. Two related to primary care. How many patients does OMP care for in terms of primary care? And what is the estimated number of community members without a primary care physician?
OMP primary care, Right now, Karen, is their panels is approximately 16,000 patients. And the last time we did this survey, I believe, in the entire county, correct me if I'm wrong, Jennifer, was it about 8,000 without at the time?
Yeah, I believe it was 8,400 did not have a primary care provider identified.
Yep.
Can I ask a follow-up to that?
Sure.
Certainly, the good news is that's a substantially less amount of people, okay, given over the years, the foundation's participated in recruiting also with the hospital. So when you look at how many patients are being cared for between OMP, Jamestown, and Nome, it's a substantial amount of patients, and there's still capacity. So is it that these 8,000 plus people, do they just not understand what they need to, how to search for a primary care, or is there an unwillingness, to have a primary care? Because I know firsthand how busy the ER is, whereas, a bulk of the population is still using that as their primary care service provider.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, no, that's an excellent question, Karen. And I think anecdotally, I believe when we talked about this, when that last survey came out, we guesstimated that there's probably a few thousand that are just not seeking primary care for whatever that reason might be. But definitely there is a need for more primary care, which is part of why it is in our strategic plan, and that will stay in there. We also try to help North Olympic Healthcare Network and Jamestown in their recruiting efforts and try to work together. Because the way it slices up is, you know, each of us is about a third of the primary care workforce. So I still think there's a need to be met, I guess, is the answer. Okay. And whether that's 4,000 or 5,000 or 3,800, it's hard to know for sure. But we know there are definitely people in the community that, you know, they're not seeking care. And we don't know all the reasons, but there's still a shortage and we're going to keep working on that.
Okay. And bravo. I mean, it's been a huge hurdle. That's for sure.
Yeah. You know, one of the interesting tidbits about me is I was hired here when Virginia Mason left. That's how I got hired, to be honest, because they needed somebody in the finance department to be working on some of those projects. And actually that's ideal. That weekend that we opened those clinics, I got hired like a week later or something like that. So yeah, I think OMC really taking that leap back then was not trivial, but at the same time, I think it's paid off. And what's also interesting, I think, in our county is each clinic has a slightly different funding mechanism. I mean, we're definitely the hospital-based, more traditional type of funding mechanism, OPPS, you know, rules. Whereas North Limbic Healthcare Network is a federally qualified health clinic, which has a lot of the dollars may come from similar buckets, it's got a different funding stream. And then the Jamestown tribe has a slightly different funding stream because of their in their with the tribal health system. So it's an actual very interesting, if you could create an experiment, which I feel like it didn't work, we didn't design it that way, but that's almost like the way this works. So it's an interesting way that we do share primary care about a third, and each revenue source is slightly different. So if you could create a way to get as much healthcare dollars into a community, this probably isn't a bad way to do it. So coincidentally.
Yeah, well, I remember that was Virginia Mason days. I was on city council and the citizens were holding us hostage to get OMC to do something. So those were tough days.
Yeah, there was, yeah, Mike Glenn and Eric, and yeah, back then, those are some bold moves, and I think it was definitely the right thing to do, and we're, you know, we've gone from those few providers to, you know, like Jennifer said, 113, so it's been a ride, for sure.
Bravo.
Karen, while I have the floor, do you want to ask the other questions that you submitted, or do you want to read those? Or
you can just read them, that's fine.
Yeah. Can I actually chime in before we move from that topic?
Sure.
Yeah. So Darryl, you mentioned Jamestown and, you know, known, they actually have far more sustainable funding models around the primary care. And you kind of mentioned that you guys share that patient population, a third. Mm-hmm. My understanding historically may be incorrect, but my understanding historically is that primary care has not, been terribly self-sustaining for OMC. And, you know, in terms of trying to maximize the benefit to the community and those revenues, if the hospital's having to support the outpatient primary care clinic, is there options around those partnerships of being able to access that more sustainable funding model that's available through the FQHCs so that the hospital district doesn't have to prop up? And again, I may be misunderstanding the underlying finances behind this, but I'm just curious.
No, that's a really good question, Wendy. And that I think what I, you know, a lot of the funding from on the tribal side and the known side, a lot of the really advantageous funding is through Medicaid through the state. But you've also got commercial payers, you've got Medicare. And I think the way I've been trained to look at primary care and the way I think about primary care is I think of OMC as a large organism and primary care is part of how that functions. But that said, if the revenue stream continues to be challenged, that's likely something that we'll have to talk about. But for right now, the fact that, you know, our primary care clinic is within 250 yards of the hospital, the revenue coming in is still good. However, if that were to continue to be cut, then yeah, I think Dr. Maxwell and Brent and others, we'd have to have some other discussions. But yeah, if the site neutral cuts, you know, continue to erode away and all those kinds of things, then you're right. But for now, the model is still in our favor for us to do about a third of the primary care at this time. But yeah, we'll have to do what we have to do if it continues to erode. So great question.
Thanks, Darryl.
Sure.
Hi, can I ask a question? I'm curious about whether you have included anything in the strategic plan related to some of the Olympic Community of Health changes. I know we all have change plans, many. So I wonder if you see how that is contributing to changes in the provision of healthcare within the hospital care setting. If you want to comment on that,
I can start, and you feel free to add in. You know, so we are involved with the Olympic Community of Health, and to date, one of the biggest successes around that model for us has been how we've added mental behavioral health services in our primary care settings. A lot of the funding that we utilize those dollars for is for that service. So that is one way that I'm familiar with that definitely has been helpful to us. The actual amount of funding that's coming to OMC it's very helpful, but I think we're still heavily reliant on operations to kind of make our equation work. Do you have other comments on that?
I just wanted to thank you for the question, Jody. It's an excellent question. And I was going to allude to the same topic of behavioral health, that we've done a number of initiatives in that arena and just recently submitted some additional documentation for another initiative in that regard. So we're actively working. Bobby Beeman is on the board of OCH for us, and I think she was just asked to be on the executive committee, which is great. So we're really very much a part of that and support it. It is probably worth us looking back at the strategic plan and actually focusing on where the OCH goals are woven into the strategic plan, because they are there, but I don't know that I would be able to point to them right now and point to a specific OCH goal. So I think it's an excellent question that we can take back to the drawing board and just draw that out a little bit more.
Yep, fair enough.
Thank you.
Couple questions from Karen that came through the chat. For doctors and staff that are new to OMC and new to the Olympic Peninsula, what's their impression of our community?
Well, I can share a little bit. Good question, Karen. I have the opportunity now to interview and orient with every provider that starts here, and it's actually been a fun process. So I can only give you, I can think of a few providers who I know are reasonably new, and I think they've settled in pretty well. I think our interview process is pretty thorough. In fact, I feel like when they're interviewing, I feel like I'm talking them out of the job, because I want to make sure they know that it rains in the winter. It gets cold, and you know, I try to make sure they know what they're getting into. So it's on them, you know, when they get here. I would say it's been very positive. I can think of a general surgeon who started, they've settled in, they got a house. I think they've started a family, and I think most, you know, Jennifer talked about our COVID story in her presentation. You know, so, and she's exactly right. So many healthcare facilities ratcheted back on salaries. They laid folks off. I interviewed a gentleman probably last fall who, you know, he basically walked into work one day and he didn't have a job anymore. And I think he was in part of a large system in the Midwest somewhere. So we were very cautious and very diligent and thoughtful in how we dealt with that. So I think the fact that our COVID numbers have remained low in Clallam County, and the fact that, you know, we double down on our staff, so to speak. We kind of bet on us, I guess I've been saying. So I think that's been a good story. And that's part of why the number of open positions we have, the number of providers is only about 10. All the rest of them are nurses and a lot of other things. So, this is all anecdotal. I don't have any statistical evidence around this, but I would say we've done a good job. And I would say the people that we've recruited have fit in nicely. and are satisfied. That said, being a doctor in 2021 is difficult, or any provider with the EMR and a lot of other things. So it's definitely a hard job. But that said, I think our new providers are doing pretty well.
I just would add to that the fact that the foundation and many of us, including me, who actually wrote the pro-levy statement and capital bond for the school district, I would be curious if the recruits are now seeing, we're a community that's investing in ourselves, because, the school conditions was horrific to recruit professionals. I mean, I'm a private business. I know the comments that I get when I have our team come in from across the country. And so I think that's incredibly important. And now with the housing issue, even for those who can afford to buy a house, don't want to get into affordable housing, but just let's talk about availability of those who have or in the position. That's going to be a little challenging here, as the market's still going to be crazy according to the last economic forecast from the real estate industry.
Yeah, that's a big challenge. And I think, we'll be doing what we can to participate with, the stakeholders working on that stuff. Obviously, I think it's going to take all of us to kind of, peel that onion. But that's going to be a huge challenge. And, as Jennifer said, with all the positions we have open, if we hired them all tomorrow, they'd have nowhere to live. Right. So we have to. That's a big deal. And I wish I had a good answer on that one. But we'll keep working with others to try to make progress in that area. That's about the best I think we can do at this time.
Thank you. Just getting to another question that Karen submitted in the chat. What is the annual projected write-off for non-billable or charity expenses for the next 3 years? And if you want to elaborate, Karen, feel free.
Well, it's been about, $7 million annually. It was higher before. Do you see that going down, or is it going to continue to climb, just given people don't want people that come into the ER, unfortunately, a lot of them do not have insurance. They have not signed up for available insurance for them with the Affordable Care Act. So, that's a big burden on the hospital finances.
Yeah, and I think you're right, is with the Affordable Care Act and the Medicaid expansion, that really helped us a lot, because we had a lot of people that we call them self-pay, or they go to bad debt. And that number went from 4 or 5% to about 1%. So that took us from about 12 million down to the 6 or 7 that you referenced. And so I've actually been surprised that it hasn't gone up more. Mm-hmm. And looking at the last, year or so with the pandemic, with the fact that, a lot of people didn't have jobs, I wasn't sure how that would influence the local insurance payments that we receive from a lot of our community members, but actually we call it uncompensated care. It stayed reasonably constant. I think it's always a percentage of revenue. So I think if our revenue continues to grow a little bit each year, which it usually does, that number will go up a little bit, proportional to the revenue. But so far I've been surprised that it hasn't gone up higher. So I think that 6 or 7 million number, if you multiply that by 3 years, is probably a good estimate.
Okay. Thank you.
In terms of the approximately 205 open positions that OMC currently has, approximately how many of them would be doctors and nurses and maybe administrative staff?
Yeah, I can speak to that. Darryl mentioned the number. Our provider recruitment has been very successful, so that number has gone down. If we pulled that number 2.5 years ago, for example, we would have had about 28 or 29 open provider positions, including both physicians and advanced practice clinicians. But that number is down to 10. So we have only 10 open positions for providers. We've been able to fill even some of our hard to fill positions. Then we have approximately 40 medical assistant positions that are open. They may not all be posted right now because there are so many that are duplicative. We don't always have all of them up on the website at the same time. My last count of the RN positions was, I believe we had 32 open or RN positions, and that fluctuates a bit. but we have definitely seen a shortage for RNs, and we have had to use travelers, which are of course more expensive. And it's also difficult to get travelers even at the present time with the workforce shortages that we're seeing. Another area, and it fluctuates because we don't employ a huge amount of surgical technicians, but I mentioned that we have an in-house training program for that, because typically if we have a surg tech position posted, it can be a really hard to fill. And then we're seeing a number of laboratory positions being hard to fill as well. And so these are really positions that require specialized skill and training, and we're looking actively at ways to train and grow from within. The administrative positions, we do have a number of registrars and other positions, and I don't have an exact number, but it would be probably in the 20 to 30, that would be the percentage of that. Rough numbers, sorry.
Yeah. Thank you. Dr. Maxwell, I see you have a question. Please go ahead when you're ready.
Yeah. Hi, thanks. I just wanted to start. Can you hear me? I'm playing with my camera here, so I've got good.
Hi, okay. Dr. Maxwell.
Sound good, hey.
Doc. I just wanted to start just by saying, first off, kudos to the hospital on making it through a really difficult year intact. I know you took some hits with the pandemic, but really a great job, and really thanks for all your contributions. The hospital really stepped up on the testing and the community, and that was a really big thing, and the collaboration with your partners to kind of make it all happen, I think helped position us on the testing side and the vaccination side for really getting in the position we're at now. So thanks and kudos. I do think the elements that you've outlined in your strategic plan revision, it strikes me as hitting the right things, the right topics. I think from my perspective, you're focusing on the right things. Good job on that as well. I guess I shuddered a little bit when I heard you talk about the workforce challenges, particularly around the medical assistants. And
sorry,
I know.
I feel your pain, and I don't think any answers. But as I was hearing Jennifer talk, I don't know what the answer is, other than start breeding MAs now, so that we can. They're just not around, and it may be something beyond all of our control. But trying to find ways to just get more people interested in that career path is what's going to happen. Because ultimately, no one is successful in attracting, recruiting that small little bit this trickles in every year, it hurts you guys in Jamestown and vice versa. So if you're successful in achieving your strategic plan, it will make it painful for me, Jennifer and Darryl. So I don't wish you too much luck in that area. We really should get together and try to figure out some way to make the career more attractive and just get more people into it, so there's enough for all of us, unless we figure out different ways to find new workforces. But that's just a comment that crossed my mind. We do value the partnerships, and want all of us to be successful, all the three, especially around primary care. And that if kind of getting back to Wendy's comments earlier, I know you guys deal with some challenges with your reimbursement model. And Darryl's right, we have this portfolio in the community of different reimbursement models that are advantageous and disadvantageous depending upon the particular population. But if the hospital finds itself in a, because of changes in reimbursement in a getting came to a corner, I think that there are partners who will want to talk with you and brainstorm about ways of ultimately making it successful, because our successes are mutually dependent, and so we want to see you there. So those are my comments.
Thank you.
Thanks, Doc.
You bet.
I have another. Oh, sorry.
Go ahead, Jody.
I have another question or just concern. So I now work in the Aging Network, and one of the stories I heard recently was from a social worker at OMC who had been working for a long time to try and get some people who have been essentially living in the hospital because they don't have any place to go or be discharged to. And a lot of it is related to behavioral health and caregiver shortages and facility shortages. And it concerns me because it's impacts a lot of different pieces, including the health of the hospital. I don't know if you have any kind of focus around that. I know we did some work at the beginning of COVID and we really reduced the long-term residents at the hospital, but it is proving to be intractable.
Yeah, I mean, that's a good point, Jody. And we have 7 right now that have been here for greater than 20 days, for example. And all of them, you're right, they do end up here. And that's part of why we want to be talking with, you know, anyone in the community that they can be a part of this, because we're not going to solve it alone. And no, this isn't the best place for some of these folks, but right now there's not a lot of alternatives, and this is considered a safe place. They can get good care. And so we're happy to provide that, but it you're right. I mean, times like right now where we're full, if those 7 folks had, you know, could be somewhere else where they'd probably be a little better off, if there was room for them, that would be good for everybody. But that's not the case. And that's part of what we really want to be working with, you know, with Wendy and Rediscovery and others to try to, how do we all make the best use of the resources we have and get these people to the right place? Because that's ultimately what we all want. But yeah, you've identified a problem, and that's something we deal with every day, as you know. So, and lately, like I said, it's been, we've had as many as 12 here that have been here for extended periods of time. And every once in a while you get those that for medical reasons, that's the only disposition. But a lot of these folks, it's not necessarily medical. It's a series of other things that, you know, but those are society's problems are here too. So, yeah, thank you for your comment. I don't know, you guys want to add anything else?
Yeah, a couple of measures that we've taken, and Jody, it's such a good question because it really does impact the hospital. And of course, it impacts these elderly folks who are being essentially boarded in the hospital. It's so sad in many of these cases, really tragic. So we have moved for guardianships in 2 of the 7 cases that Darryl just mentioned. So our legal department is working actively to have a guardian appointed for those individuals because they don't have anyone to make decisions for them. And that's what we're finding is in many of these cases around the dementia or geropsych and other issues that might be being suffered by these patients is they don't have someone who can help them make decisions. And so then we can't get them to a safe disposition in the next area of care. So another tactic that we've taken is working with our legislators. And I think we're really interested in working more with the community and collaborating and perhaps getting more help on the legislative front. We expanded the informed consent statute, for example, not this last session, but the session before. And we were able to add, in addition to family members, an adult friend. And there's several criteria that the person can't have any financial interest. They can't profit from helping the individual. And so it's very protective. I think it was well written. But it does add that next person who can help make decisions, because what we're seeing in many of these, as I mentioned, very tragic cases, is there either isn't a family member or there are family members who've even abandoned this elderly patient. And so we're in need of someone who can help us move them to the proper and appropriate care. Another measure that we took with the legislature just this last session was we were able to get Steve Theringer mm-hmm. introduced a budget proviso on our behalf, and the Washington State Hospital Association was really thrilled with this because it ultimately was included in the budget. And what it allowed was an enhanced rate for memory care for those organizations that provide services for dementia and Alzheimer's and others. Conditions. So we were really excited that we got that included. I think it's a $5 million per year addition with $5 million in matching federal funds. And of course, that doesn't impact OMC directly, but it does help us to be able to get our individuals who need to get to the next long-term care place in a more timely fashion, and we can then get acceptances. So we're continuing to work. All of our legislators locally are really involved, especially Steve Theringer with long-term care. He's on a committee for that. And the more ideas that we can bring to the table and continue to partner on this, it's a big problem and bigger than OMC can solve, but we're really interested in moving ahead.
I feel like we've been talking about long-term care deficit for a long time. You know, a few years ago, it was really about those substance use users who had MRSA infections that really they could have gone to a step down to recuperate and rehab, but we had issues with facilities being unwilling to accept those patients. I feel like we're having that same conversation and have been having that same conversation for about 2 years now, maybe a little bit longer, with, you know, our aging population and the lack of resources for memory care here in the community. And I wonder, you know, I know that Darryl and Jennifer, you guys are, you know, involved with our skilled nursing providers to some degree. I wonder if there's been any talk of OMC maybe contracting and, you know, subsidizing some beds at a skilled nursing facility to be able to provide them some additional trainings and supports or other creative options that, you know, as we look at the next few years, you know, our population is significantly aging. Jefferson County is much older than we are by like 4 years, right? And they're the oldest county in the state. You know, the population in Sequim has an average age of something like 55.9, which means we have a lot of people at high risk for needing this, these kinds of services. I also want to comment from earlier, just quickly to say, I'm really impressed with OMC's ability to kind of grow your own staff. And, you know, as we're looking at using resources, whether it's skilled nursing facilities or ED utilization, those sorts of things, I think it's imperative that we're looking from a community standpoint about how we're using our resources most effectively. You know, where do we need to invest in RNs? Where do we need to invest in MAs? Because we're certainly seeing workforce shortages across healthcare nationwide, whether it's MAs or CNAs or nurses or behavioral health providers. I mean, we have huge problems. And so, you know, OMC has done a really great job with the Grow Your Own program, which is great at your scale. It's a little harder, you know, in some of the other industries or some of the other clinics in the area. But we appreciate, because we also sometimes end up with great employees that OMC has done a wonderful job training. But this, you know, this
hey, wait a common... minute. Are you taking our people, Wendy?
Very rarely, but every once in a while, I've got a couple really amazing MAs. Thank you. They've been here for a long time now.
All right.
We won't talk about how many of my people have come over there, Darryl.
Okay, I'll be quiet.
Wait a minute, Wendy.
But it really, it all comes back to resource management, right? From a community standpoint, not just, you know, what does OMC need, but, you know, we have difficulty with creating those career pathways in our community. There's not a lot of paths to higher education, you know, and we've certainly shared those concerns with Luke Robinson up at the college that, you know, from a healthcare standpoint, we have no career pathway for social workers. And, you know, OMC didn't used to employ social workers, but now OMC employs, you know, a lot of social workers, and we employ social workers, and Mike employs social workers, and Brent's hiring social workers. So, you know, there's a need to grow some of these other professions. And if OMC can help support too with helping drive the college, they don't have to do it all internally, but it would be great if we could have them help us create some career pathways for students to move beyond our local college into higher education programs that support some of those more challenging positions for all of us to recruit.
Mm-hmm. I'm so glad.
All in one comment.
Well, I'm going to pick up on the workforce one if I can. I'm so glad you brought it back to that, Wendy, because I agree with you 100%. And the comment I was going to make with regard to Dr. Maxwell's input on the MAs was that if we can work together, what we really need is an influx of individuals who want to go through a career ladder and work, you know, through these jobs, and we have to build that ladder. So in the work that we've done with the legislators, again, I'm wondering if there are opportunities for 2022. Just yesterday, we were planning the priorities for the North Olympic Legislative Alliance, NOLA, which works with the Economic Development Council. And we're already planning for 2022, and we had some great success this last session. And the one priority that I brought up that I just wanted the folks to consider was workforce development. And it might not be adding spots at Peninsula College this next go round. Maybe it's subsidizing the wages of medical assistants, or maybe it's helping to develop the career ladders that you just talked about, Wendy. I don't know exactly what the answer is, but we've got a lot of smart people on this call and in our community. And so if we can get some kind of proposal that we advance, I think, you know, we have some very supportive legislators, and perhaps we can get some funding in that regard that would help us in the workforce arena. They get really excited. I mean, our state legislators get pretty excited about workforce and especially economic development and all the ways that it brings life to our community. So I think we could get some support if we come up with the right idea.
Mm-hmm. Thanks, Jim. Yeah,
and back to the earlier part about how we thought about ways to move people into other beds, and how do we, I think that's, you know, one of the key things in our strategic plan is community partnerships. And, one of our providers challenged me to, do an inventory of these different agencies that are doing a lot of this work. And, but I think what it does lend itself to is similar to your conversation about workforce is, how do we work together? And maybe there are some strategies where, we can be involved and help, because again, if these folks could go somewhere else where they're well cared for and they're safe and their loved ones are comfortable, and it gets them out of here where somebody who really needs medical attention can be seen, I think we need to be exploring those things. But again, I think it's that out of the box thinking. And I think there's so many agencies that have their hearts in the right place and they're trying to do really good work, and they do. But how do we sort of join up, kind of like some of the discussions we've had around behavioral health with you guys and others, super productive, very positive, everyone's trying to do their best. And so I think in a lot of these ways, we're going to be flushing some of these things out, because we, none of us can really go it alone anymore. And so, so these community partnerships are key to the plan, and I think key to all of our survival. And I'm actually excited about that, because I think as a community, we can get a lot of stuff done. We just got to figure out the right pathways to do so. So definitely more to come on that.
Thank you. Does anyone else have any other questions or comments? We appreciate the input and the dialogue.
Hey, it's Anne Marie Henninger. And I just wanted to say thanks to everybody who came into the call. It has been so helpful to hear your feedback, and it's just really valuable. So thank you so much for making the time to attend.
Thank you.
Thanks, Anne-Marie. And I also wanted to, does Gene Hordijk or Tom Olbach, feel free to add anything that you would like or anything that we missed, if you're so inclined, as well. So we do have three board members on the call with us, and just want to give them that opportunity.
You can find more info about OMC's strategic plan at olympicmedical.org/plan. And if you have follow-up questions, you can email community@olympicmedical.org. We really appreciate everyone joining us today and being a part of this discussion. Thank you.
Thank you all.
Thanks, everybody.
Thank you.
Thank you.